3! Showtime!
Well, over 7,000 fans join in with the man in the yellow tux and all smiles from Luis Castro, the first baseman, as he leads it off. You saw it in the highlight we showed you a couple minutes ago. Two long balls in High Point, North Carolina last night against the Rockers. He almost gets out of the box, which would have been a called strike by Vincent Chapman, the home plate umpire. But he is a quick learner. He's still in there. This one fouled off. Fans might be able to make a play. No, that went into the concourse and a 1-1 count.
Yeah, and if you look down that right field line at those bleachers, you've got a little section that really juts up and out of this ballpark. You could very well see a catch from a fan over in that section as it is Castro lining one into right field and Noah Bridges charging on in will make the catch for the first out tonight.
The former Colorado Rockies and Milwaukee Brewers minor leaguer, a teammate of Reese Hampton and Jake Scholes a summer ago, and they were all on the Gastonia Honey Hunters together here in the Atlantic League. Good lumber, but it finds a glove. And now it will be Ricardo Cespedes, who, as you can see, is having a terrific year here in the Atlantic League, which, for those who may not know, is the top independent professional baseball league in the country. Those in the business compare it to AA, AAA type talent in the minors. A little glove-to-glove action from Dalton Malden to Eric Jones Jr. And a great start for Cowboy Kyle.
Yeah, Kyle Lewig's working very quickly. 1 minute and 13 seconds into this inning. And how about that? The Bananas playing on some turf tonight, and you usually don't see some odd bounces off the turf, but it was Dalton Malden just doing a slight adjustment there and a nice touch with the glove flip over there to Eric Jones Jr.
Cowboy Kyle Lewig's waving to Josh Nye in the booth. It's good to goof around with our buddy in Soho last night as Josh had his head in the statistics.
What a gentleman.
he's a good guy. Shattered bat over the leaping attempt of Ryan Cox. Oh, so close from the glove magician. It is going to be a flare base hit for Angel Aguilar with two down.
Yeah, that's a really tough play to have to make. Ryan Cox really didn't have time to turn around at all, just had to jump at the last second. And boy, kind of costly in the MPI department there for Kyle. Would have gotten him out of the inning in sub 2 minutes.
Which there have been 69 such innings in 70 games so far on the tour. Of course, this game 71. Nice front door slider to clip the inside corner here to Chris Brito, the third baseman. And quick 0-2 count. That one nearly took out Jesse Cole, who has his arms up in supplication. How that could possibly happen to the owner of this team. Brito actually was a member of the Trenton Thunder when that was a college baseball team in the first half of the MLB Draft League earlier this summer. And then when he was not snagged by a Major League Baseball team, took his talents just about an hour northeast up here to Staten Island.
Hey, who can blame him? Stay local.
That's a fact. Right of Charlotte, North Carolina. Flicks that one over the leap of Dalton Malden. And a couple two-out singles. Have a pair of FerryHawks on the bases as Ryan Cox takes a spill. Was able to grab the ball, and everything's kosher with Aguilar at second base.
Yeah, two tough two-out hits for Kyle Lewicks, both just over the gloves of his middle infielders. And now it's Kyle who will have to work out of a little bit of a first inning jam here.
Bobby Sparling, more connections to Banana Land. He was a JUCO guy at Daytona State, just barely missed Dustin Baber. Although the party animal second baseman did play with Bobby's older brother, Matt. Really impressive southpaw on the mound who pretty much averaged 93 with his heaters. He went to Florida Atlantic, was in the Padres organization before getting hurt and leaving baseball, but his younger brother, Bobby, is still kicking. Just below the Mendoza line with the batting average so far this summer with the FerryHawks. Right fielder trying to get hot here in this challenger game as Malden will bounce it to Ryan Cox. A trick play for the songbird of our generation. His 29th in 31 tries. And Cowboy Kyle survives the two-out singles.
Yeah, and not surprising that it's the Bananas going with a little bit of trickery early here in this challenger game. They're averaging 6 a game, and Malden getting it started early there to get Kyle out of the first.
So nice that you get to see it twice. Shout out our incredible team in the control room down in Savannah, Georgia, switching the cameras and controlling the replays as you take a look at how these FerryHawks line up defensively from left to right in the outfield. Brandon Pugue, Ricardo Cespedes, and Bobby Sparling. Third to first in the infield, it is Chris Brito, Angel Aguilar, Garrett Cooper, and Luis Castro. Well, behind the dish is Chris Zaleski, and on the mound is Ryan Skillman.
Yeah, and you've got a Staten Island FerryHawks team that actually comes in ranked last in fielding percentage in the Atlantic League, a 972 mark. So this is a team not the greatest defensively compared to their competition, but we've seen a lot of these challengers really step it up in games against the Banana. So look for some trick plays and see if they can't just make the basic plays right to retire these Bananas.
The numbers here you see for Ryan Skillman are across 3 years he had at the Academy of Arts out in San Francisco. And they don't jump off the page, but from what we've heard, is a crafty right-hander and will not be an easy cookie for the Nanners to try and get to crumble.
Yeah, and if he just paints the corners, has some good location, you get the feeling that he's going to have success. Really, the main things for him to be concerned about, the things associated with his whip, his walks, and the hits that he allows. If he can limit base runners, he'll probably be fine tonight for the FerryHawks.
Which, of course, is ship in banana ball. Sprints instead of walks as you take a look at the Bananas lineup. Eric Jones Jr., the first baseman, is the only man who is actually due to hit, because if the tour leader in long balls sends one toward the New York Harbor and it escapes SIUH Community Park, well, that will be it for the first inning. Waiting in the wings is Michael Deeb, Dan Oberst in the hole. And a couple sliders, couple swings and misses for EJ. Quick 0-2 count. And another cut and a miss. That was the White Castle special. Three sliders for Eric Jones Jr., and he's down on strikes.
You know, I'll be honest, I thought you were calling it the White Castle special because that was straight cheese.
Quite the opposite, buddy. So EJ, the former Mariners and Twins minor leaguer, is retired. And Michael Deeb, former White Sox farmhand, gets a called strike. 1-1 count on the third-year banana holding down left field. Comes in hitting 317, a 383 on base percentage, slugging 460, all of those will get him in the top 10 on the world tour between Bananas and Party Animals.
And let's not forget Michael Deeb, also swinging the bat pretty well, walk-offs in two of his last three games, and here on a 2-1 count, lining one right up the middle. It actually evades Skillman there, or should I say Skillman evaded Deeb's ball. With Michael Deeb on first base, only for a couple seconds, it's Malachi Mitchell coming in as Michael Deeb and Adam Viro gonna hug it out after that barrel.
That's what you love to see, Viro in his adopted home state. Nanners coach alongside Tyler Gillum, originally from Nebraska, lives in Jersey City, so I guess he's on the wrong side of the Hudson. I digress, though. Well, grounder to short, and Angel Aguilar fires that one high. Looks like it was going to be bang, bang at first, though. Dan Oberst was busting it down the line. I don't even know if that throw would have been in time.
Yeah, it's one of those situations where you'd really like to try and get a replay on it. This game moving so fast, I'm not sure we're going to have the time to. For now, honestly, I think I'm willing to give Dan Oberst, a single there.
It's a single in my book, but put a star next to it. Under further review. 1-1 count on Dakota McFadden. The on-deck hitter Danny Hosley is the only man with more walk-offs than D-Mac. In his third World Tour, he's the first man selected for the One City World Tour back in 2021. And the kid out of Rocky Mount, North Carolina, continues to slug. Batting average at .288, his 9 homers, tied for second on the tour with Reese Hampton, who we had on the broadcast right off the top in the pregame show. Lines that one deep to left center. Tracking it down will be Ricardo Cespedes. And two outs, Malachi Mitchell. The potential inning-winning run still in scoring position. Shout out Greg Sharon for tossing out 10 gift memberships in the YouTube chat. That is awful generous of you, Greg. And now from the man in second place on the tour in walk-offs to the tour leader himself, Danny Hosley. Two more than Dakota McFadden for a grand total of 24. This one served in the air, shallow right. And making the call and the catch is Bobby Sparling. Both teams get two men aboard in the first inning. Neither can score. And we don't have a score after an inning in the books. Let's find out why the captain, Bill LeRoy, was the showman of the night in Trenton on Wednesday.
Yeah, we've got Bill LeRoy collecting his third showman of the night this season. And boy, he had a great game. It started defensively for Bill. Here in the second, we've got a runner on second base. And Bill firing a strike over to third base, gunning down that runner. And I'm telling you, we talk about this 3-2-2 all the time, but I don't know a better catcher at those 3-2-2 moves than Bill LeRoy, and he could pick one in the dirt there. And now we get to the ninth inning, jumping ahead all the way to this point. It is Bill coming up with, I've got to admit, this is the most elaborate walk-up that we have seen all tour long. Bill doing a little friend like me from Aladdin. We've got Jake the Magician getting in there. Is that Zach Frangelo doing some ballet? Doing some flips? It sure is. And look at Bill selling this bit so hard. All of his teammates there to greet him. I'm telling you, Biko, you ain't never had a friend. Never had a friend. Never. Never had a friend. Never had a friend. Never. Never had a friend like Bill LeRoy. And boy, he was really friendly at the dish, too, as you're about to see in a second, nailing the ending to that walk-up. How about Ryan Cox getting in on it, too? Only saw four pitches, and Bill said, you know what, that's enough. This game, it's coming to a close. Ryan Cox would come around and score on Bill's walk-off double, and boy, he is getting held up by Michael Deeb. Nobody more fired up. And by the way, powered by some chocolate milk, as we learned after the game.
Yeah, ended up spilling it on the jersey to the chagrin of Danny Hosley, Noah Bridges, and Vinny DeRubius, the clubbies on the bananas, as Bill and company fired up to start inning number two here in game 71. The Savannah Bananas against the Staten Island FerryHawks. Both teams put a couple aboard with a pair of singles in the first inning. Neither could get a runner to third base. And now it's going to be 6-7-8 for Staten Island as Brandon Pugh blasts that one out to left center field. Hosley not able to track it down. He will hit the cut. Pugh digging for three. Throw from Cox. In time! What a relay from the glove magician to take care of Pugh.
Ryan Cox, such a smart baseball player. We continue to rave about the trick plays, but this guy continues to do everything right that a shortstop should, getting in good position there and firing a strike. And it's Jackson Olson, who again is just now back defensively for the Bananas, who's able to hold that third base back and apply a really great tag. Huge out for the Bananas and Danny Hosley, who really didn't read how deep that ball was going out to left center off the bat there.
But it was a perfect throw to the cutoff. Textbook stuff as Chris Selesky, the catcher, will swing with a man down. 0-1 count. Bill sneaks behind Selesky, and that is a startling thing for a challenger. And good to see laughs coming from the FerryHawks in the third base dugout. They really enjoyed that one. Peter gets the outside corner, 1-2 count now. Make it 2-2. Selesky, a guy who spent all 5 years of his collegiate career at Rutgers University, Newark, on the other side of the New York Harbor. That's a well-positioned fastball. Blows it by the FerryHawks catcher. First strikeout of the night for Kyle Lewix.
Yeah, and that puts Kyle Lewix just one strikeout away from triple digits. So be looking to see if Kyle tries to get another strikeout and get in a quick 0-2 count here against Garrett Kiber.
Kiber out of Clarksville, Tennessee, who went to school in his home state at Austin Peay. Also went to California, a little action at Moore Park College. a guy who started his summer with the Southern Maryland Blue Crabs. Only 12 games in Southern Maryland before playing the lion's share of his summer here in Staten Island. 54 games on the docket. And Cowboy Kyle would certainly love for his 100th K of the tour to get the full capacity crowd here in the Big Apple. Free donuts courtesy of Duncan. Heater just misses a tad up and in. Luigs, four-seam, two-seam cut fastballs and slider, the primary pitches. Fools around with a splitter, dabbles with a changeup. And now the count even at 2 balls and 2 strikes. Cut and a miss! The slider gets the job done! Kyle Luigs is the first man to 100 strikeouts on the 2023 tour. And everybody here in Staten Island is getting free donuts thanks to Duncan.
I mean, that's killing two birds with one stone right there. And it's Kyle giving us the 100, taking a bow. Yes, Kyle, yes. We're not worthy. We're not worthy.
What a perfect time. As we get another look at the K and the celebration for Kyle's teammate for the past 5 years here in Banana Land, Mr. Dan Oberst, the designated hitter for the Nanners here tonight to join us in the broadcast booth. Dan, how cool is it to get to see that moment right there?
Pleasure to be here. Perfect timing to walk up. My roommate Kyle, best friend for years, gets the donuts. 100 strikeout on the tour. I'm proud of him.
Yeah, that's what it's all about right there. And Dan, obviously a little bit of a health scare last week for you on Thursday night.
Yeah.
You banged your head on the dugout, and it turns out as absolutely mythical of a human being you were not able to win that battle.
Yeah, it's a funny story, you know. The biggest advice I can give, I'm not going to go too far into it, it wasn't an anger thing. I didn't, like, try to headbutt the dugout. But when you're running into places where the roof is low, make sure to duck. You're not going to win. It's going to hurt. And you're probably going to be out of your sport for a little bit. But we're back.
That's a fact, buddy. Well, listen, we are so happy to see you back in the lineup, man. And obviously, we call your hometown Largo, Florida. Mm-hmm. But you spent the first 8 years of your life here in New York out on Long Island. How special is it for you to be back in the Empire State?
Yeah, it's been great. My parents are here, about 60 other family members. We're rolling pretty deep tonight. Did Bananas Royalty with my little cousin. Got gifted a pair of insane cleats tonight. Yeah, absolutely insane. Anthony, Lucia, I mean, these are the craziest cleats I've ever had.
So yeah, we'll have to try and zoom in on them when you are back down on the field in your second at-bat, which I would target probably about a third or fourth inning ETA on that. We're back to the action here in SIUH Community Park. Just like in the first inning, the Nanners only need one run to earn the first point available tonight. Ryan Skillman back out on the bump. It's 6-7-8 for the Nanners, and Ryan Cox sends it towards the Staten Island Ferry Hub. That thing probably had the distance to leave the park if it had the direction.
Yeah, yeah. Cox has been swinging it, man. He's getting loose on some balls. He's got some confidence. It's coming soon.
Couldn't agree more. Still in the hitter's count, and that is no longer the case. A little underhand flip from Luis Castro to Skillman.
I'll tell you what, Beeks, this turf is slow.
I'm sure
you could probably see it on that ball I hit off the end of the bat. I actually asked Malachi, because I was just head down running, if they tried to throw to second, and he told me they didn't. Couldn't really believe it.
We gave that an infield single.
Well, yeah, I mean, thank you to this turf. I believe it is an infield single, but I don't know that I've ever had one like that.
It's fascinating. This ballpark was built in 2001, and it was all natural grass for the entirety of the Staten Island Yankees tenure here, low A affiliate of the New York Yankees, of course. And then this is now year three that the FerryHawks are the main team playing ball here, and the second year that the turf has been the playing surface.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, unbelievable view for you guys. I just looked up and I'm pretty taken back.
It's not bad.
it's got to be one of the best you've had, right?
I don't imagine there's a possible better in the history of the world.
Yeah.
Anytime I feel like we get to look at Lady Liberty out there, you know, we're doing all right.
Yeah, I mean, this is beautiful. I'm not going to lie. The entirety of the time I've been up here, I haven't looked up, and I just looked up and saw that, and wow.
Well, your teammate over the past 5 years saw it off on what looked like a righty-on-righty changeup there, 2-2 count. What can you give us here on Ryan Skillman, who certainly doesn't look like he's lighting up the radar gun as Bill barrels that one down the left field line, and he is digging for two back-to-back at-bats for the Bananas catcher, notching doubles. Now all of his teammates, sans Dan Oberst, are going to go out there and party with him as he's one of the first guys to solve the Ryan Skillman puzzle.
Good barrel there. Yeah, EJ came up to me after his at-bat, relayed some stuff like he always does. We're kind of working with a middle approach, staying up the middle. It's not as firm as some of the guys we saw the other night from Trenton, not as firm as some of the Party Animals guys. You know, I was thinking stay in my back hip, but again, it's not as firm as we've been seeing. So I think guys will start making adjustments here and you'll start seeing some loud barrels. It's just going to be staying within ourselves, not trying to do too much.
Obviously, just one at bat, and we've only seen him here in an inning plus of work. Mm. Any comparison to facing Sean Fluke?
I'll have to see the breaker. I saw the heater, you know, it's not so much different, but Fluke can really spin it. I haven't seen this guy's breaker yet. Fluke commands 3 to 4 pitches every time he goes out there. So when I see this guy's breaker, I'll give you a little nod if it's the same as Fluke.
Okay, we will be keeping a close eye out for it. Jackson Olsen, only his second at bat back after getting knocked in the face by Dylan Porter. Errand pickoff attempt.
Oh boy.
Annapolis, North Carolina, screaming line drive.
Good barrel though.
Yeah, Castro is there to grab it. So in classic Jackson Olsen style, he has had 2 plate appearances since returning from the injury, and he has seen a total of 4 pitches.
Really good to see that barrel, though. You know, the guy missed a lot of time, and it looks like he hasn't missed a beat. Swing looks good. He's been killing it in BP, so glad to have him back.
I mean, you're still seeing the aggressive approach from Jackson Olsen, and believe it or not, you know, getting his first start since July 12th, this is still a guy technically riding a 3-game hit streak.
Yeah, I mean, from a hitter's perspective, if you're kind of, the great Jake Skoll told me once, you're kind of either the predator or the prey.
Yes.
And Jackson seems to have the predator mindset. He's getting in there and swinging it. He's not taking pitches. He's swinging at strikes, controlling the zone, and obviously loud barrels. So looks promising.
Noah Bridges tried to send that ball into lower Manhattan, still ahead in the count 2-1. And pops that one over our heads.
Really loud BP from Noah today. That right field is a good place to hit it here, guys. That wind tunnel really has some carry to it. So see if we can get some balls in the air that way.
I mean, Dan, just to compliment you a little bit more than we already do. I mean, such a great opposite field hitter as Noah Bridges will go down on strikes and still scoreless after 2 innings. Dan, you're a great opposite field hitter. I mean, as many hits to right as you have left this season, what's your secret to just being able to drive the ball out that way? And you've got home runs as well going out to the opposite field.
Yeah, a lot of it's approach. If I try to get too big and kind of pull home runs, I'll tend to roll over, get a little too rotational. So if I try to set my sights on staying right center or center, then I'm going to be able to go that way, and the pitch in I'll get to, and then hopefully naturally pull a home run. But trying to stay to right center is my best approach. I know I got an infield single my last at bat, but that was probably a result of me trying to get a little too big. So, you know, we'll take the knock, but hopefully next at bat I can stay through the middle and drive something in the gaps.
We'll be seeing that in an inning or two. For now, Maceo and the boys boogieing. We'll let them take it away and be back with Dan Oberst after this.
Let's hear it for your Bananas player!
Well, the players deserve a resounding round of applause, which they get. So does Maceo Harrison, who led Vinny DeRubius, Malachi Mitchell, DJ The Invader, and Alex Ziegler through a dance that you knew the good folks in the Empire State were going to absolutely love.
One out. Just in case I got to come up in a big spot, you know?
100%.
I love being up here with you guys.
100%. Okay, that's great to know. Yeah, because, oh my goodness, Dan, you are due up fourth in the bottom of this inning.
Yeah, I might come up with a runner on, so I'm gonna try to drive that ball in the gap for you guys.
Well, Mr. Oberst, we cannot thank you enough for joining us in the booth, dude. It's always a blast. Cool to be in the state you spent your first 8 years of your life in, and I would wager that the Staten Island ferry and the harbor that it inhabits is calling your name tonight.
Yeah, you guys are the best. Thank you for having me up here. Just a shout out to you guys, my dad, everyone that watches. Can't compliment the two of you enough. Biko and Josh, you guys are amazing. So thank you for having me. Thank you for all you guys do. Oh, boy.
Comes the heartbreak dog. Hi, Michael Deeble.
Yeah.
Loses the glove. Catches the ball barehanded.
How about that? What an ending. I love you guys. Thanks
love
for having
too,
me.
Dan.
You know what I love even more than possibly than Dan Oberst? When Michael Deeb throws that club away and makes the barehanded catch. Sixth trick play of the tour for Michael Deeb, and it couldn't have come at a better time to start this inning. Incredible banana ball field from Michael Deeb, getting the banana, second trick play of the night.
That takes care of the designated hitter, Noah Fisher. And now the extra hitter, Mikey Edelman, will try and get aboard here. It is 9-10-1 for the FerryHawks in the top of the third inning. 1-0 count. That means Kyle Lewis is going to bring in Ryan Cox, Dalton Malden, and Danny Hosley for a little choreographed dance. This is a doozy. Oh, baby! What? A whole lot going on here. With the took assist to home plate, Kyle will secure a foul ball from Edelman.
We talk a lot about Jake Lealios of the Party Animals and his hip movement, but I've got to tell you, Kyle Lewis might have just rivaled it just there with that 3-2-2.
Hips don't lie from the six-year banana, spent 4.5 years of his college career at the University of North Georgia, living with his battery mate, Bill Leroy, and finished up at Jacksonville University. 1-2 now coming. It's going to be just about 120 feet from home plate. And that ball's cranked deep to left field. Edelman leaves the ballpark. Solo home run. FerryHawks lead the third inning on a pitch that traveled about 120 feet before it went over the wall. More than 330 feet away in left field.
And there's nothing that Cowboy Kyle can do but tip his hat right now to Edelman. I mean, a lot of confidence to go about throwing the pitch there with a 1-2 count, but it was Edelman completely unfazed. And boy, the guy's celebrating at home plate like they've won the World Series.
And this is a guy who spent a good majority of this summer on the FerryHawks, played 62 games, was batting a bit below 200. So he got released from the squad, and that has to feel oh so good for Mr. Mikey Edelman. Sends that thing out to the land of good and plenty. And then the FerryHawks strike first. There's still work to do to secure the point as we get to the top of the order here. Mikey had 2 home runs in 161 at-bats for the FerryHawks this summer. Boy, if they were just pitching from second base, what a monster he could have been. Slider is able to get Kyle Lewis back in the count against Luis Castro, who lined out to right his first time. Beat around the bottom of the zone, count even at 2-2. Slider is taken. Former teammate of Jake Skoll and Reese Hampton, ready for a payoff pitch.
Yeah, and Skoll and Hampton both saying Castro, a really great hitter, and you saw it there on his ability to hold the swing on that slider, but it's Cowboy Kyle going back to the well and getting the K on Castro, his third of the night.
And what you love to see from Luis is looking back to watch the strikeout call from our dancing home plate umpire, Vincent Chapman, and a smile nearly ear to ear from the FerryHawks first baseman. He's bought in on Banana Ball, and it warms the heart to see.
It's a spectacle a lot of people want to behold. And I mean, Castro, one of the guys, as this one lined just past the diving glove of Ryan Cox there. Another two-out hit for these FerryHawks.
Ricardo Cespedes, a ground out to second his first time, is aboard, and now Angel Aguilar, the shortstop who singled and was stranded on second base in the first, will swing away. And an 0-1 count as that one grazes the outside corner. Look out, Angel. He was not ready for the 0-1 offering. Kyle says, my bad. The pride of Barinas, Venezuela, is prepared for the one ball, one strike offering.
And oftentimes that's something you see Kyle do against challenger opponents, is this one's going to fall into center field. Kyle, he likes to mess with batter's timing. He'll go with the quick pitch a lot of the time, but that one seemed to really catch Aguilar off guard. So he's gonna give a little payback there to Kyle, lining that single into center.
Now Chris Brito, third baseman, a single his first time. Chance to add to the third inning lead for the FerryHawks. They have one run in on the Mikey Edelman long ball. But remember in Banana Ball, you need to win the inning to get a point. Right now the Bananas only need one run to tie it, two to win it. But the FerryHawks not done here in the top of the third. Back into a hitter's count. 2-1 now. Out of the Rutgers product. Shot foul on a fastball. It looked like a two-seam for Mr. Lewis.
Yeah, and you can expect Kyle, who likes to work off the slider most nights, go to that pitch here with the count at 2-2. See if he can't get a chase or maybe perfectly locate one on the outside part of the plate. Now Kyle decides to go fastball. He knows what I'm doing here.
Dangerous pitch coming. The all-time leader in homers for Rutgers. That one misses up. And here's our first sprint of the night for the FerryHawks. All seven fielders behind the pitcher and catcher have to touch the ball before it's live. That's going to allow Cespedes to score from second. Aguilar goes first to third. And wisely, Brito is content with just one base on the sprint.
And that's a tough ball four sprint there allowed from Kyle Lewix. You typically do not see him allowing sprints, especially with runners on base. And there, he thought he was going to get the strikeout call there from Vincent Chapman. Instead, it's a second run across the board for the FerryHawks here on the top of the third.
Now Bobby Sparling, the right fielder, who loops that one into left, and it is a 3-1. Three-run, top of the third inning for Staten Island. Bobby bounced into a fielder's choice. Trick play from Dalton Malden his first time. And FerryHawks showing why they have a great chance to in the back door in the Atlantic League playoffs here. Just three games out of first place in the second half. This one chopped towards Oz, and no chance for Biko to make the snag. It was caught on a ricochet. Nice snag, but it has to be straight from the bat into the hands of the fan for an out to be called. Sawed off and barehanded. Ryan Cox across the diamond. Scoop from Eric Jones Jr. will stop the bleeding. But the FerryHawks, three runs on four hits. They strand a pair, and let's get another look at the Mikey Edelman solo home run out to left on the 120-foot pitch from Cowboy Kyle. Edelman knew it right off the bat.
Again, just when you thought it was Cowboy Kyle who might get his third strikeout with that kind of pitch, it's Edelman firing up the FerryHawks more than we've possibly seen any other challenger team get excited this season.
Jesse Cole breaking out a brand new promotion. It's Belly Busters. Let's throw it down to our owner as we head to the bottom of the third.
We got one.
Two.
Oh, we got two.
That's a headshot that works. Go. Splash zone, here we go. Boom, yeah! Oh.
Six.
Five.
Here we go, we're at six here. Seven.
Six. Seven.
Oh.
Eight. Nine. 10.
10 seconds.
11. 12. 13.
Oh.
14.
Five, four, three, two, one.
16, all right.
Young professor, how many did you get over there?
We have 16 over here.
16. And on this side, they have 16. Nick and this side's got 17.
Oh.
And there you got it, the first ever belly buster bonanza. Good job.
Hey, give it up for Scotty though over here, everybody.
The first ever big belly buster bonanza. I don't know if I said it all in the right order there, but it was a smash hit. That's a fun one. Anytime we're in a place with a second deck.
Yeah, anytime you can get some of the bananas in full jersey up there in those upper decks, you can't go wrong.
Get a good look here of Staten Island University Hospital Community Park. And now we zoom in down on the field where Dalton Malden jamming out to his new single. We might be biased, as the songbird of our generation will lead off the bottom of the third, 10, and then the top, Malden, Jones Jr., and Deeb. We love just about everything, and I'm gonna amend that statement. We love everything that we have ever heard out of the recording studio of Dalton Malden, but this song should be a Billboard smashing hit.
It feels like it should be top 50, and there's no doubt about it in my mind. And look, I've got to be honest, I really didn't think that anything would top Miss You, Love You. That's actually been one of my favorites, but boy, this one might just top it.
See, I'm a cherry lime guy myself as Dalton takes off, and there is our first steal of first on the evening, exactly what the bananas need. They're in the business of base runners, trailing the third by three runs. They'll need three to tie it, four to win it. And Dalton Malden has his second steal of first on the season.
Yeah, and the first time we saw Dalton Malden steal first base on this year's tour, it was actually the 100th steal of first for the entire tour. So really great to see Dalton Malden actually, it was the 100th stolen base of the season for the Bananas. And now Dalton picking another wise time to go ahead and steal first base as he fakes taking off for second as Eric Jones lofts this into center and the catch made for the first out.
This time, Josh, you're not going to believe it. It was the 200th steal for the Bananas on the tour. And we've got a special walk-up for Michael Deeb coming from the crowd. Finish from the big titty out of the newsies there.
I mean, look, if there's anything I'm learning recently, it's that Zach Brangelo is really gunning for either Aladdin or Newsies to win a split seat for best walk-up on this year's tour.
Yeah, that's back-to-back games where An absolute doozy of a theatrical walk-up, of course. The one that preceded this was Bill Leroy's third at-bat in Trenton, which was followed up on the 2-1 pitch with a game-winning double. Let's see if Michael Deeb can provide some heroics as Vincent Chapman checks out the newspapers that were hurled in the air. Who says print is dead?
Okay, sorry.
Deeb a single back up the middle his first time, cranks this one to right. But perfectly positioned out there is Sparling for out number two.
Yeah, another hard hit liner off the bat there of Michael Deeb. But like you said, perfect positioning here for the FerryHawks. And now it's Dan Oberst who's going to get his second look here at Ryan Skillman. Let's see if he points up to the booth at any point.
Looks like Bobby Sparling possibly live streaming this game right now from right field. He was fired up. He just got that liner. He's definitely at least videotaping there. Dalton Maldon broke towards second. Didn't notice any kind of a nod from Dan after he does see a bender from Ryan Skillman. I'm still perplexed at the fact that Dalton Maldon got the 100th steal on the tour for the Bananas with a steal of first, and in his second steal of first, grabs the 200th steal on the tour for the Nanners.
Look, I'm all for my statistical oddities, but this one is blowing my brain a little more than I thought it would.
Almost a nice catch by a woman down there on the ricochet. She ended up sending her phone cascading down onto the concrete steps, and it looks like it's no worse for wear. Technology is getting better and better with age. There's a cut and a miss from Dan Maldon back after a back pick from Chris Selesky behind the dish. Deuce is wild here in the bottom of the third inning. Skillman one strike away from securing the first point of the night for the FerryHawks.
And that was Dan Oberst trying for a home run swing there with the Bananas being down 3 runs in this inning. That was Dan trying to get them back in this just down one.
Payoff pitch misses. Here is the first sprint defense that the FerryHawks need to pull off. They get it around the infield awful well. Outfield crashing in. Dan's going to try for 3 bases, and he's going to have it. All 7 FerryHawks behind the pitcher and catcher. Touched it in pretty short order, but Mr. Oberst, as fast as you are legally allowed to make a first baseman, of course the DH tonight, will pick up his 33rd RBI. And now he allows Dakota McFadden to represent the potential inning-tying run at the dish.
And we've seen some challenger teams really step it up when it comes to sprint defense. But for the FerryHawks, I mean, you're seeing a little bit of a slow start and really didn't see the infielders start to crash together around second base. Outfielders also weren't shading in, so that was a big part in Dan Oberst being able to get into third base. And now the Bananas have a legitimate shot at getting within 1 run or even tying this inning. Of course, it's Dakota McFadden swinging a big bat.
Talked about it his first time, but his 9 homers are tied for second most on the tour. This is one of the best hitters in Pecos League history. Cut and a miss on the slider. And for the second time in as many hitters, Skillman is a strike away from earning the FerryHawks a point. 1-2 pitch. This is down. With the righty-on-righty changeup, which has had a decent amount of success for him tonight. Changeup is what got Noah Bridges struck out. Although, of course, that was righty to lefty, but I digress. This one right back up the middle. Skillman has to find his tush as the Bananas within a run of tying the inning. Throw goes all the way to first from Cespedes in center. And now Danny Hosley represents the potential inning-winning run at the plate.
Yeah, Dakota McFadden tattooed that ball up the middle, and there was nothing that Skillman could do except get out of the way of that one, as he gave Dakota McFadden a pretty long stare after he reached first base there.
T-Mac grabs his 42nd stake of the season, one behind Eric Jones Jr. for the team lead, as Hosley sends that one out of the confines of SIUH Community Park. Full capacity crowd. The 270th straight sold out Bananas game. I beg your pardon. All YMCA-ing. Now the They fixate back in on the action. Malachi Mitchell pinch running is checked on by Ryan Skillman. Second time Flash the Kid has been a pinch runner tonight. Banana Ball, you can pinch run with your automatic runner one time through the order. One misses down, and Flash the Kid has his tour leading 65th swiped bag in 70 tries.
Yeah, and Malachi picked a good pitch to run on with Skillman going breaking ball. Now he's in scoring position with the Bananas leader in batting average with runners in scoring position up at the plate in Danny Hosley.
And the tour leader in walk-offs. Haas has ended 24 innings. He has three long balls, so he's got the pop to make it 25 walk-offs. A little excuse me swing, and the play will be made. Garrett Keimer makes sure that the FerryHawks are able to win the inning. 3-2, they take the first point tonight and lead 1-0 in the all-important points category after three innings in the books. Let's send it down to the Bananas dugout. Time for some Little League intros from the fellas.
Thank you. With the Little League World Series starting this week, let's meet the starting nine for your Savannah Bananas.
My name's Michael Deeb. I like to pop barrels and eat cheeseburgers.
My name is Danny Hosley, and I'm a sexy beast, baby. Yeah.
My name is Noah Bridges, and I think I got my swagger back. Oh!
My name is Jackson Olson, and my favorite singer is Taylor Swift. Taylor, you belong with me.
My name is Ryan Cox, and you're watching Banana Ball.
My name is Dalton Walden, and I want to be a singer when I grow up.
My name is Eric Jones, and I'm cooler than the other side of the pillow.
My name is Bill Leroy, and I love Donnie's mom.
My name is Kyle Lewis, and when I grow up, I want to be just like Hasbulla.
Well, happy Little League World Series season to everybody out there who celebrates, which I hope is everyone spending their Friday night with us here in Banana Land.
You know, I always thought Dan Oberst was cooler than the other side of the pillow, but I guess he'll cede that title to Eric Jones tonight.
Well, of course, he's going to have to. Dan, the designated hitter, doesn't get a say in the matter. EJ, the other primary first baseman for the Nanners, holding down that spot tonight. As we get to zoom in on SIUH Community Park, looking down on it through the banana panorama. And the first pitch, a tad high in here to Chris Selesky. 7-8-9 for the FerryHawks, and with a 1-0 count, Vincent Chapman calls time, dusts off the plate, and throws his mask away, dancing as only Vincent Chapman can, to the delight of the full capacity crowd. The hat nearly took out Bananas catcher Bill Leroy there.
I don't know what exactly you would call the move that Vincent Chapman did before getting to the ground there, but I really liked the arm movement, the circular movements there from Vince.
Could not agree more. Got a pinch hitter here, Vincenzo Aiello. Well, come on in and swing it. Guy who got up to double A in his baseball career. We'll swing it for Selesky. 3-1 count now. He was a two-way guy, but the majority of his professional career has been done as a pitcher. That is, you know, he made it up to double A in the Miami Marlins organization and high A for the Chicago White Sox. This one bounced to second. Dalton Malden handles it and over to first for out number one. Fa- fascinating pinch hit move there from the FerryHawks. Celeste had struck out in his lone trip to the plate. Makes sense why they would give Yellow a chance. Now it'll be a man who is supposed to be swinging in the eight hole. Garrett Kieber, who struck out swinging to gift the full capacity crowd donuts, thanks to Duncan his first time, and he's gonna pick himself up a double here in try number two.
Well, the crowd decided to give him the thank you for striking out as tonight's donut hitter, and he wanted them to know he can swing the bat a little bit, poking that one out to right center field, and a big extra base hit. The FerryHawks continuing to hit Kyle Lewigs well early on in this game.
Now Noah Fisher, the DH. Peter misses pinch up and out. Flew into a trick play out, recorded by Michael Deeb and left his first time. And now the entire Bananas team dancing as a fastball yanked outside, 2-0 count. Fisher out of Northern Kentucky University gives this one a ride out to left, but Deeb able to track it down in front of the warning track and ascertain out number two.
Yeah, two straight flyouts now from Noah Fisher out to Michael Deeb, and he was positioned very well to be able to make that catch. Strong throw in, held Kyber there at second base. By the way, Biko, I've got a question I've got to circle back to here.
Yes.
We saw the Little League World Series intros here from our guys. Let's role play here. You're down on that field. What are you saying?
Say that I'm Biko Scala, but the ladies call me Rico Suave. Snap throw down to second in time. Bill Leroy with a laser beam. He picks off Garrett Kieber. And that will end the top of the fourth, as the FerryHawks want a challenge on the play at second. We'll take out the Riedel headsets and chat with Vincent Chapman and Zach Frangelo. Yeah, we're ready to rumble, Vincent. Yeah, that's a tough one on first look. It was a snazzy slide there from Kieber. Vincent hoping there's another angle as we look again from low home and haven't moved. And oh, here we go, from high home. I don't think this isn't gonna tell us anything different, I don't think.
Yeah, we're gonna need to see that the old angle zoomed in there.
Try one more time from low home, but right now I can't overturn it. Yeah, he's out. So the FerryHawks lose their challenge.
The ruling on the field is base.
And what a heart-stopping play there early on, as John Byrne, in only his third banana ball game ever as an umpire, he was out there in the black in Durham, North Carolina as well, withstands the challenge, and the Nanners just need one run here in the bottom of the fourth to even this game up at a point apiece.
You know, it makes sense that the FerryHawks wanted to challenge that play, as, you know, on review, it was a lot closer of a play than it looked, because Dalton Malden, you couldn't quite tell going back in the instant replay whether the tag was applied or not, but towards the end, you see Malden kind of get it around that hip area for the out.
It's Hey Baby O'Clock here in Staten Island, New York. Over 7,000 fans. that make up the full capacity crowd here in the 71st game of the tour, the 101st banana ball game ever played in front of fans. All fired up. Looks like Jared Donaldson still trying to digest the news that Bill Leroy is such a fan of his mom. That was shocking information to hear from the King of Dublin, Georgia. Surprising that Split is not joining in on the festivities. He is stone cold staring in from 385 feet out in center. And Ryan Kellogg, he certainly is having fun up in the second deck.
Dude, he's just chilling up there in one of the suites. I'm telling you, he's probably chowing down on some food, maybe introducing some people to some of his Canadian ways here in New York City. It's the melting pot after all.
That's a fact. You get another look out at the New York Harbor. From left to right, Jersey City, Manhattan, and Brooklyn. And of course, the Statue of Liberty, situated out in the waters, right on the edge of New Jersey and New York. Highly controversial which state Lady Liberty resides in.
I did not know that.
It really looks like, when you look at a map, that the Statue of Liberty is in New Jersey. And it pains me as a New Yorker to say that. The more you know. Bottom of the fourth inning. Back out there on the bump is Ryan Skillman. And he comes in for 6-7-8. Ryan Cox, Bill Leroy, and Jackson Olson, who are all one swing away from knotting this game up at 1 point each.
And we saw the pair of Ryan Cox and Bill Leroy do damage in the ninth inning against the Trenton Thunder. And now it was Ryan Cox who got the single in the ninth in the last game, getting ahead in this count, 3-1. We'll see if he can draw a ball for Sprint and maybe take advantage of another Sprint defense falter from the FerryHawks.
It was relatively sturdy Sprint defense when Dan Oberst notched a three-baser in the third, but of course, as they will get another chance here from short, second, third to first, four out of seven, now left, center, and right, and Coxie able to trot into second with a two-base sprint. When you see the bananas and party animals at the peak of their power in sprint defense, it is awfully, awfully hard to get two bases.
Yeah, and that's because you can see the outfielders who so early on start to shade in little by little, and especially when you get to the full count, sometimes you really have to sell out and just, you get that feeling that there's going to be a sprint that occurs and you're able to get there to the second base bag very early, and that's how you're able to hold runners at just first base on a sprint.
Ryan Cox, the potential inning-winning run in scoring position as the FerryHawks tried to pull off a hidden ball trick. Skillman was on the mound, though, so wouldn't have been legal if the tag was applied. But I digress. Bill Leroy has walked off two games in the past 3 weeks with Ryan Cox on first base and Bill notching two baggers. Now his shortstop 90 feet closer. And Mr. Leroy already a double in his first at-bat tonight. Gets that one through the left side of the infield. Coxie, with a tough read, charging it well was Brandon Pugh, and coming over to cover third was Skillman, so not taking any chances, he stays pat at second.
We had both of the infielders for the FerryHawks crowded around each other on the left side of the diamond, and it was a ball that I don't think Ryan Cox thought would get through the infield, and the left fielder came in charging very hard. It's just one of those unfortunate situations where Bill collects the hit, but it's Ryan Cox who's unable to move up any bases.
Jackson Olson in his third plate appearance since returning from the injury he suffered in Kannapolis, North Carolina, quickly behind 0-2. Lined out his first time tonight.
Oh.
There goes Coxey. Bill following him towards second. That's where the throw goes, and it is not in time. Mr. Leroy, 10 for 10 in his stolen base attempts. Coxey, 8 for 8 over at third.
That's where you see the Gillum aggression. No outs, and he wants to get both of his guys in scoring position here. Now all it's going to take is Jackson Olsen being able to get one on the ground or somewhat deep into the outfield that could score Ryan Cox from third base.
We're going to have a mid-at-bat pitching change with a 1-2 count on Jackson Olsen. We're going to have a new arm here in the ballgame. Mike Morrow, the manager for the FerryHawks tonight, is going to bring in the lefty specialist who gets the strikeout. Unbelievable stuff. He's not on the roster, so who in the world knows who is wearing number 22 for the FerryHawks?
Well, our mystery man just threw one big pitch to get Jackson Olsen there. And now he's going to face another lefty here in Noah Bridges. And we'll see if the lack of warm-up pitches affects him at all as he falls behind Bridges 1-0 to start this plate appearance.
1-1 count now on Noah, who struck out his first time against Skillman, who, by the way, gets credit for that strikeout of Olsen since he left the count leading 1-2. Infield in for the FerryHawks. That one to the backstop. Cox coming home. This game is tied at 1 point apiece. The rare walk-off for a base runner. Ryan Cox has a baker's dozen walk-offs now on the tour.
Yeah, and that was great work by Ryan Cox, who had a nice lead from third base, seeing the pitch get away and coming in to score there for the Bananas, who have now tied the FerryHawks at 1 point apiece as we go to the top of the fifth.
Thrilling first four innings so far here in Staten Island. We'll throw it down to Jesse Cole. Time for some father-son catch.
Nothing says the spirit of baseball like a father-son catch. But in banana ball, a father-son catch is a little bit different because we have four kids down here and two dads. We have Christian and Jackson and Landon and Cameron. And for our father-son catch, we're gonna have the kids run full speed out into the field and the dads have to catch them. So, Christian Jackson, Cameron Landon, go, full speed, full speed. Keep going, full speed, full speed, full speed. Now dads, catch them. An old fashioned father son catch, here we go. And there it goes, Christian and Jackson are still running in the outfield. And dads coming after Cameron and Landon, they're splitting each other. Smart strategy by the kids. Look at them chase Christian. We got one in the outfield. And he's giving up on that, son. He's going for Jackson. But we almost have the second one. And Landon and Cameron were caught first. There you have it. Just another father-son catch.
Sometimes we create a promotion just because we think it's funny to say it. Let's just set a couple kids loose and have their dads try and track them down, which is a preposterous ask, but surprisingly, this dad able to make it happen.
I'm going to try and do that with my father the next time he's at a Bananas game. I'm volunteering for it right now. My brother and I, we could really cause some chaos out there.
Dad, I love you. There's a 0% chance you could catch me in an open field. Too elusive.
See, that's what I'm saying too, but I want to challenge my dad, you know?
Oh, Dennis Scala is a very athletic 53-year-old. But, I mean, unfortunately, those genes pass to his son. We head to the top of the fifth inning. This one popped behind home plate. Bill Leroy pursuing it. He won't have a chance. The fans do, but they cannot come up with it. In fact, more worried just about protecting themselves, which is fair. That ball was a homer in an elevator shaft. It's the bottom of the order here for the FerryHawks trying to feed the top. Mikey Edelman, the extra hitter. A homer his first time. And now a clap resounding throughout SIUH Community Park as Eric Jones Jr. joins Kyle Lewigs on the mound. Kyle dipping his hand in some unidentifiable liquid. What's happening here? Eric Jones Jr. Oh, he lights the ball on fire! Kyle Lewigs is Lady Liberty, and he gets a strike on the flaming pitch! What a K!
Oh my goodness, it's Kyle Lewigs nailing the strike three, looking. Billeroy just happened to keep hot potatoing that ball in the air. It was so hot.
That one thrown back into the dugout as it is still smoldering. Strikeout number four for Cowboy Kyle as he raised it up like the Statue of Liberty that is straight ahead of us here out in the New York Harbor. And now a 1-0 count on Luis Castro at the top of the FerryHawks order.
When in the Big Apple, my friend. When in the Big Apple.
How about Edelman? He is a homer on a 120-foot pitch, and then he is struck out by a ball on fire.
You think that feels like some redemption for our friend out there?
I think in some sort of fashion, it certainly is. Bouncer to Jackson Olsen, crow hop across the diamond in time. And Castro now adds a ground out to the ledger in which he had struck out and lined out earlier.
That was one of those situations where it was Luis Castro trying to take a page out of some of his former teammates' books. This is a guy who played with Reese Hampton and Jake Skoll, and they're guys who love swinging on 3-0 counts. And it was Castro who, again, swinging the bat very well for the FerryHawks, who was looking to try and lift a ball over the outfielder's heads for some extra bases there.
Now Ricardo Cespedes, former New York Mets and Miami Marlins minor leaguer, drives that one to right. Noah Bridges will grab it. And an easy breezy 1-2-3 inning for Kyle Lewigs. Nothing out of the ordinary. All he did was light his hand on fire. He had a strikeout, ground out, and fly out. What's new? As we head to the bottom of the fifth inning, Anders just needing one run to take their first lead in points tonight. We are joined in the booth by Jake Schwartz, who has a magic trick for us.
That's right, Biko. Now, New York is a place where travelers from all over convene. And so, Biko, I want you to think of a celebrity traveler who could visit us here in New York. Don't say it out loud, but just think of somebody. Do you have somebody in mind?
I do.
Okay, I'm gonna ask you a series of arbitrary questions and try to deduce the celebrity that you're thinking of, okay? So this celebrity gets here, but they're here from an appearance somewhere else. Where are they coming from?
They're coming from Saskatchewan, Canada.
Saskatchewan, Canada. Okay, that's strange. That's a far away, very specific place that they're coming from, Biko. They get here, they get one piece of food. They say, I got this great thing to eat while I was here. What are they eating?
Chopped cheese.
Chopped cheese, also a very specific thing. So I'm thinking, Biko, maybe this is a very well revered person, possibly somebody in pop culture, but somebody who people very much respect. Maybe it's not an athlete, I'm not sure, but this is just what I'm getting from your arbitrary answers. Who is it? Who's the person you're thinking of?
It is Kate Hudson.
Kate Hudson, okay, so that could work. That kind of made sense. That didn't make sense. I don't know. Here, you can show this to the camera. That was kind of what I was writing down here. And Biko, I told you that New York is a place where travelers come from far and wide. And so my backpack is equipped here with a luggage tag, but not just any luggage tag, Biko. This luggage tag specifically is coming from Kate Hudson, coming from Saskatchewan, Canada, planning to eat chopped cheese. Hopefully you guys can see that. I'm going to try to get you a little.
Yeah, I had to zoom in a lot with the first
one. All right, let's see if I can get even closer here just to get the people at home a good shot here.
Yeah, give it a little closer, a little closer.
A little closer, a little closer. It does say the things that Biko was thinking, I promise. Oh, there you go. Maybe that's a good shot
right
there.
Right at the tail end.
Yeah, there you go.
Jake, I don't know how you do it, but you keep one-upping yourself, man. I don't have words.
Well, thank you, Biko. Yeah, Banana Land, we're always trying to get better, always trying to do new things, and on the broadcast is still the same.
Okay, you'll have another one for us tomorrow night.
That's the plan, and I'll see you guys then.
Thank you so much, Mr. Schwartz. I don't get it, Josh.
My brain just alakazammed out of the broadcast booth.
0-2 to Noah Bridges. John Doe on the mound here because the FerryHawks are using a pitcher that does not exist according to the internet. Josh is still flabbergasted by what just occurred up here.
What made you go Kate Hudson?
There's a story behind that. Noah Bridges lofts this into shallow center, and out to grab it is the shortstop Aguilar for out number one. Bridges 0-2 on the night, 9-10 and one for the Nanners here. And how about this? Alton Molden, a steal of first base and a run scored after coming out to his brand new single that is out on Spotify, Apple Music, all of the above, How Do You Keep Her, which should already have a gazillion views or plays, whatever you want in the music world. And Matt Wolf will take his place in the 10 hole, drops Trow, now picks those suspenders back up. Man out of Joy, Oklahoma, now an Oklahoma City firefighter, gives our mystery man on the mound a strike because that is how confident Matt Wolf is in succeeding as he represents the potential inning-winning run.
Look, Matt Wolf has a hit on the season for the Bananas. It came against Brett Helton. But now, can he handle a bigger task and get one here against a challenger opponent and the Bananas, a base runner? I think Matt Wolf just shattered his bat there.
Yeah, that one right off the end. He'll need a new weapon. And Dan Oberst tosses it to him, at least tries to. Didn't quite make it there. I am dying to know who is pitching. You know, as a broadcaster, I like to pride myself on hours and hours of research and being able to tell these guys' life stories. It frustrates me beyond any possible imagination that we just have literally no idea who this person is on the mound.
Sidearm Steve.
Okay, perfect. Sidearm Steve with the payoff pitch. Good blink from Matt Wolf. That one misses outside. Third time that the FerryHawks have to do some sprint defense. They get it around the infield well, but once again, the outfielder is a little late to the party. And after three bases for Danny Oberst, two bases for Ryan Cox, Matt Wolf gets the latter treatment.
Yeah, and you really didn't see Matt Wolf miss a beat running the bases there. Made sure to touch first base. Just a small little stumble, but you saw the aggression immediately out of the box, and it's the Bananas who want to keep him in and run in this situation with Eric Jones up at the plate against Sidearm Steve.
To the top of the order we go. EJ is struck out and flown out. And ahead, a ball and no strikes. Former Minnesota Twins and Seattle Mariners minor league product, put up excellent numbers in both systems. And without a reason that we could possibly understand, both teams gave up on the talent, but not enough for the Mariners to completely say goodbye to him. EJ was their bullpen catcher last summer, and you can look on the calendar when that team turned it around is literally the exact date in May that Eric Jones Jr. joined the coaching staff. The bullpen became the best in baseball, and they marched into the postseason, took down the Blue Jays in the wild card round, and took the Houston Astros to five games in the ALDS. This one sky high in the infield and grabbed by Angel Aguilar for out number two.
Yeah, Eric Jones just got way too much lift on that ball. Tried to stay back and be a little patient as you see those sidearm guys usually not throwing the ball especially hard. And for EJ, it's just going to continue a trend of what is coming into tonight, six straight games without a run batted in for him. The longest drought he's seen all tour long.
It'll be up to Michael Deeb to be the hero here in the bottom of the fifth inning. FerryHawks won the third, Bananas won the fourth. Each team with a point, with two outs and a runner in scoring position here in the bottom of the fifth. One count on Vitamin D, a single his first time, a line out to right, his second trip to the dish, which was hit even harder than his base knock. Cut and a miss. Sidearm Steve, certainly a tough customer on the mound. Nothing straight, really funky delivery. And this one popped in the infield. This time the man to grab it is going to be Chris Brito. And the Bananas fail to capitalize on the scoreless inning gifted to them by Cowboy Kyle. It is still 1-1 after five innings.
Yeah, and that's what you saw the side armor do best. A lot of soft contact. It was three pop-ups in the infield that got sidearm Steve out of the inning in just a second under 5 minutes.
We'll throw it down to Matt Gray for the young professor. Time for grandson, Grandpa Gridioff.
Vince, they've got a Gritty all the way to second base, and the granddads are going to come on out, and they're going to go and Gritty all the way back home. Vince, Bryce, you guys ready? Then on your marks, get set. Go, let's Gritty it up. Here we go. Hit that Gritty, boys. Looking good. Stylish. Styling and profiling. They're staying close. Bryce is in the lead, but Vince is coming up behind him. And we've got Allen and we got Bob. They are 67 and 71. And here they go. Hitting that Gritty. Look at them granddads go. Oh, look at them. That granddads are styling, profiling. Oh, he touches the bag. Allen might be in the lead by just a little bit. It's going to be close. Got a Gritty. Hit the Gritty. Stepping on first, give it up for Bob, your winner. Bob and Bryce are the grandson, Gritty, Gidia.
On the mound for your Bananas, number 33, Connor Big Butter Higgins.
The 6'5" southpaw, first man out of the pen for the Nanners tonight. Cowboy Kyle goes five innings of three-run work, earns a point, loses one as well. And the former Los Angeles Angels minor leaguer, who averages about 94 to 96 miles per hour with the fastball, adds in a slider and changeup to boot, will start the top of the sixth inning on the bump.
Yeah, and Connor Higgins, a guy who, again, throws the ball hard, but it's all about control and location for him, and you can usually tell pretty early on if he's got his stuff going. That's a positive sign for Connor Higgins, a first pitch strike here in the sixth.
It is the beef of the Staten Island FerryHawks lineup, 3, 4, and 5. This one lifted right side of the field by Aguilar, the shortstop. And it comes down in the mitt of Noah Bridges, who tosses it behind his back into the crowd. Chris Brito, the third baseman now. Single in the first, and an RBI sprint in the third. That one laced towards center. Denny Hosley knocks it down with the diving attempt. And Brito, 2 for 2 on base for the third time.
Yeah, and you can see Danny Hosley crashing in hard. Got a great jump on that hard hit liner. And here's what I noticed. It was Danny Hosley who had the eyes light up and wanted to lay out for it. And you see a great jump by Hosley, making sure he got some glove on that ball so it wouldn't continue to roll all the way to that warning track and go for extra bases for the FerryHawks.
Now the big Sun Devil on the mound, former Sun Devil at that, 3 years at Arizona State before the Angels drafted Higgins. He has a 1-1 count on Bobby Sparling, the right fielder. That one all the way back to the backstop. Looked like it was supposed to be a backdoor slider, never even got to the back porch. And it'll be a wild pitch with Brito taking second. One a mile high into shallow center. Danny Hosley can't see it. Oh, he can. He was just trying to deke Brito on second base. He has out number two.
You know, it's pretty fun when you can see the Bananas pull out some of the tricks you'll see from the Party Animals outfielders. There's no one in center field who likes trying that move more than Reese Hampton, and Hosley finally getting the chance to try and test it up. but he gets the out, doesn't pay any more dividends than that for the Bananas.
Now it'll be Brandon Pugh, the left fielder. Double his first time. Grounded out to short in his most recent trip to the dish. 1-1 count. Fastball low, now 2-1. You got a Grove Hill, Alabama. Attended the University of North Alabama in Florence. Higgins thinking like he might throw to Brito, but neither Wolf nor Cox there to receive the throw. And a foul tip at the dish, so Chris Brito is going to have to head back to second base. He's off on the pitch.
And we're seeing a lot of encouraging signs in this outing from Connor Higgins. Opponents are not batting very well against him overall in the season. That includes the Party Animals. They're batting below 250 against Higgins, and he continues to just try and let these batters put the ball in play, and so far two outs, but he's run into a full count here. Can he bear down and get a strike?
This one flicked out of the ballpark, so he's going to have to get one in the zone once again. Of course, no free bases in banana ball. Brito will score easily from second if Pugh can work a sprint here. And Brito's figured it out. On a payoff pitch, you could be off on it. Because if a ball is thrown, he gets to run for as long as it takes for the Bananas to get all seven fielders behind the pitcher and catcher to touch the ball before it's live.
You know, it also helps that the FerryHawks have seen this situation from the Bananas a couple times, as it's Bill LeRoy who is going to snag that ball before it possibly rolls out of play and into foul territory, getting it over to Eric Jones for that out. Wow!
He's took it right off the head of Brandon Pugh. He mossed him. That was a magnificent play by the six-year Banana. And Higgins with a successful inning of relief as we honor all the military members, both past and present, here in SIUH Community Park. And we send that to everybody watching at home here on BTV. We welcome in Mr. Jesse Cole, owner here of this ball club, the man in the yellow tux, the reason why we are here in my home state. Jesse, how cool is it to bring banana ball to New York?
It's special. Basically, to come down and get set up right out in front and see that beautiful skyline, New York City. And then immediately at 9 a.m. when we're coming here, fans are out here greeting us. It has been absolutely amazing.
I couldn't agree more. And what a challenger here, Jesse. How about the Staten Island FerryHawks? This has been a terrific ball game.
It's been outstanding. You know, this was a big test for us. 10 challengers this year. Could this work? How quickly could players adapt to the game of banana ball? And I'll tell you, after this one, we have only one left. It is proven that they can adapt. And, you know, these guys, Staten Island FerryHawks and then Trent and Thunder, in the last few games, they're having fun. They're playing fast. They get it. I mean, a home run on the 127-foot pitch is absolutely amazing. And seeing them celebrate, this is what it's about. It's seeing guys have fun. It's been a joy to watch.
Yeah, two of the best challenger games I've ever seen. It boggled my mind that Mikey Edelman was able to hit that 120-foot pitch out of the ballpark from Kyle Lewicks. Probably the craziest thing I've ever seen in my life.
I'll tell you, I'm in the dugout. I'm like, hey, that's great banana ball, all right? For what it is, I'm sorry, Kyle, but that's great stuff. And that's what you want to see. Things that you've never seen before on a baseball field, that's what makes banana ball great. And the players bought in. Boy, I'm so excited and so happy for what's to come, because we're seeing it come to a whole nother level right now.
Tie game, Jesse. What's your prediction down the end of this thing?
I'm going to mix it up tonight. I think it's going to come down to the last inning.
Couldn't agree more. Thank you so much, my dear friend.
I love you, Biko.
Love you too, Jesse. There goes the man in the yellow tux who started this team alongside his wife, Emily, who is a New Yorker herself. Jesse, the pride of Scituate, Massachusetts. Back in 2016. And boy, what a turn this organization has taken since the collegiate summer baseball team that it was at its inception. Now on our 26th stop here on the 2023 tour. The 33rd city ever to see live banana ball is the Big Apple. And sidearm Steve still out on the mound. It's been pretty baffling for the Nanners. He has the meat of their offense here, just like in the top half of the sixth inning. It is 3-4-5 in the bottom half, and Dan Oberst ties Dakota McFadden. That is his tour leading sixth steal of first base.
Yeah, and it's not shocking that Dan wanted to take off. We'll see Dan, as much as he loves getting his ABs in a ball game, taking off for steals of first base, especially when he gets behind in two strike counts. That's exactly what you saw from Oberst. And now watch, he'll probably be very active on the base pass, trying to possibly steal second and even third.
And the Swifty summer continues. Folks here in Staten Island thrilled that Taylor's blasting through SIUH Community Park. Dan on first base represents the inning-winning run. And he's 90 feet closer as Dakota McFadden, the second straight at-bat, has a line drive single. He drove in a run with his previous base knock.
And that's where DMAC has probably benefited from having a lot of teammates come into the dugout and give a scouting report on sidearm Steve. McFadden did a really good job staying patient, staying back on that pitch, and driving it into left field. The Bananas with a nice rally here in the sixth.
Sidearm Steve gives way to William Kerwin. And Dan Oberst steals third base. Nobody was even covering the bag. He is now 36 for 41 in steals. Most stolen bases in Banana Land, except for Malachi Mitchell, as Dakota McFadden was trying to take second. He is currently tied with Bill Leroy for the most steals without being caught. They each of them 10 for 10 on the tour in their attempts. Infield in for the FerryHawks. And DMAC will take second base. There, on his second try in as many pitches, is his 10th steal in as many tries. Check that, 11th. He now takes the lead back from Leroy, who had tied McFadden only three innings earlier tonight.
Yeah, and now you're seeing a very disciplined AB here from Danny Hosley, chopping this on the ground. And this one, not going to be handled by the shortstop, trying to get a throw into home as quickly as possible. Instead, it's going to get the Bananas their second point of this ball game as they've taken the lead for the first time tonight against the FerryHawks.
A rocket off the bat of Hosley, too hot to handle for Angel Aguilar at short. And the hands on the knees never stop. Turns into a bit of a Rihanna Super Bowl dance. And the Nanners have their first lead of the night in the all-important points category. They're up 2-1 with six innings in the books. As we enter the seventh, it, of course, is time for us to give away a pair of Hokas. First, you get to take a look at the missed stab there by Aguilar on Danny Hosley's tour-leading 25th walk-off, and welcome up into the broadcast booth alongside Josh Tulevsky. No, we're not in the broadcast booth at all. Yeah, we are. Alongside Josh Tulevsky, I am Biko Scala. So happy to have you spending your Big Tiger Friday night with us here in Banana Land. It has been a wild first six innings, and it only gets crazier from here. 1 point lead for the Nanners, and the important part of coming up to the broadcast booth, Josh, is we're giving away a free pair of Hokas thanks to our good pals over at Zappos. You have to click the link in the description on YouTube or in the comments section, fill out all your contact information, and then in the buzzword section, you will be putting... Didn't even give you a warning on
no,
that.
No, you really didn't. That's okay.
Started drumming. Pastrami! Pastrami is our buzzword tonight, so in that column, you want to put pastrami. You like pastrami, Josh?
I do like pastrami. However, I regret to inform you, I've yet to make it out to a New York deli, but it's in the cards. I want you to know that. It's in the cards.
Yeah, the problem is when we get to travel around the country, and I just mentioned a little while ago, this is our 26th city so far in 2023, is quite often it's all work and no play, especially for the statistical savant of Banana Land, who probably has more work than anyone in the organization, which is saying something.
Fear not, buddy. Does not make Josh a dull boy.
Hey, we're going to send home the alley-oop, Nolan Daniel, in his fourth year as a Nanner, first as a pro, the two-time Coastal Plain League champ. Big part of the reason why the Nanners went back-to-back in 2021 and 22. Throws a very heavy sinker, works in a slider and a changeup as well. It's the sinking fastball by the catcher for the FerryHawks, which is still Vincenzo Aiello. Second man to catch on the night as he came in for Chris Zaleski. Vincenzo grounded out his only time.
And it's Nolan Daniel who continues to pitch in higher leverage situations for the Bananas. And here, a great breaking ball on the inside part of the plate is going to catch the FerryHawks catcher looking. And Daniel racking up the strikeouts and still yet to allow a ball four sprint in his Banana Ball World Tour career. It's been very crucial in him succeeding so far early on in his Banana Ball career.
Now it is 7 1/3 innings without firing, four balls in one plate appearance on the bump. Nearly clips Garrett Kieber. Second baseman for the FerryHawks sends that one out to right center. Hosley in pursuit and has it on the run for out number two.
Once again, a good jump for Danny Hosley. We've seen him man some corner in outfield positions. And we're going down to Jesse Cole because it is Dakota Stilts, Old Britain, coming into this game to pitch for the Bananas.
Old Britain!
To the delight of the full capacity crowd here in Staten Island. The 10'9" reliever for the Nanners, who has been almost nothing but spectacular on the mound this tour. Really just one bad outing that has ballooned his stats. But 24 of his appearances, he has left without allowing a run.
Yeah, and that is 10 of his innings pitched this season. So you're continuing to see Dakota Stilts Old Britain do remarkable things out there on the mound. You like the first pitch strike you're getting from him there. And this is a guy who actually induces a lot of fly ball outs out there on the mound for the Bananas.
Fisher with the 1-1 count on him. He has flown out to Michael Deeb twice. One of those was a trick play. Deeb going bare hand with the left hand. This one lifted towards the fans. They are not able to catch it on the fly. So a 1-2 count on the FerryHawks designated hitter. Fisher coming to the FerryHawks by way of the Gateway Grizzlies in the Frontier League. Ryan Cox with his entire body on the ground, able to grab the pop-up for his 113th trick play of the tour. And he will take a nap with Michael Deeb and Eric Jones Jr. to celebrate.
I mean, it's nonchalant at this point. Maybe it was all a dream.
Shout out Drizzy. Our trick play king gets his first of the night. And the Banana Band blasting away. A reminder, this is our Hoka giveaway inning. Our buzzword tonight is pastrami. Time to get a little look at what we did in the ripe rundown. Recapping everything in July. Check out what was happening in Josh's July Jeopardy.
It is time for Josh's July Jeopardy.
This is Josh's July Jeopardy. Now, here's your host, Josh Tulevsky.
Thank you, Yvonne. Welcome into Josh's July Jeopardy. We've got two returning ripe rundown rivals looking to square off, and let's get into the categories for today. Potent potables, batters who have homered off of Kyle Lewig's, colors that end in ELO, what's in Biko's backpack, all responses will start with the letter B, and celebrity banana ball guests. Biko Scala, you have not given up an earned run on this year's tour. You may select first. Thank you so much, Mr. Tolevsky. I will take banana ball celebrity guest for 200, please. And the answer, this former celebrity World Series champion tossed two innings in July, although Bryson Bloomer boomed one of his balls out of Lone Mart Field. Yes, Biko.
Who is Jake Peavy?
Incorrect.
Who is Jeremy Guthrie?
Correct, Kyle. You are on the board. You may select.
What is Banana Ball guest 600?
This former Banana Ball head coach stroked a single and sprinted across the diamond for several on-field interviews during the trip to California. We won't talk about his at-bat against Sean Fluke. Yes, Biko.
Who is Eric Burns?
That is our head coach. Let's go back to the board. Biko, you may select.
I'll take celebrity Banana Ball guest for 1,000. This
That is actually literally the first time that I have gotten to see that, and boy, did it just tickle me silly.
Yvonne Trezak, Chris Sachi, and the mind of Kyle Lewis, man. They're cooking up some special stuff for the Ripe Rundown.
Yeah, you may be surprised. That was our starting pitcher's idea. Cowboy Kyle is the reason why we had Josh's July Jeopardy. As Cox lines that one to center, he's now 0 for 2, had a two-base sprint, and walked off the fourth inning on a wild pitch, scoring from third. So the Nander shortstop in the six hole retired. Now Bill Leroy will swing it. Jackson Olsen on deck. 2-1 lead for the Nanners in the all-important points category. Only two outs or one run to go here in our Hokas giveaway. Our buzzword tonight is pastrami. Bill Leroy, the catcher, 2 for 2. And a double and a single so far on the evening for the Prince of Banana Land. Of course, gets that nickname alongside his battery mate tonight, Cowboy Kyle. The duo, both in their sixth year as Savannah Bananas, second as pros. 2021 Coastal Plain League and Breakfast Bowl champions. That one snagged out of the air. Leaping grab. What a play by Garrett Kieber.
Actually, I think that is Noah Fisher who has been inserted into the game at second base here. And look at the vertical. It makes sense why you want a guy like that as your late game defensive replacement. Wow!
You're spot on. Noah Fisher with the cowboy hat on. Goes to the top shelf where Mama hides the cookies. And now with about a 90-foot pitch, just a bit high, is right-handed Ralph, our new man on the mound, who once again is not a rostered Staten Island FerryHawk. I don't know where they're finding these guys, but boy, do they look like baseball players.
Getting them at the harbor.
Wrong city, but that'll play.
I knew you'd say that.
We are on the harbor. It's just no one would ever say it like that here in the Big Apple. Jackson Olsen tries Fisher again. That one's going to be an infield single. Would have been a tough play for the fresh defensive replacement at second base. And Mr. Olsen, now 1 for 3 on the night, has his first hit since coming back from getting hit in the face with the ball in Kannapolis back in July.
And it extends a 4-game hit streak now for Jackson Olsen, and that's where you saw one of the things that Dan Oberst was talking about earlier tonight when we had him up on the broadcast. The ball really dying on the turf there, and Jackson Olsen hustling down the line, able to get on now with two outs. Can Alex Ziegler do something big at the plate with the giant bat?
He pinch hits for Noah Bridges, who's 0 for 2 on the night. Ziggy does have one hit on the tour with the 39-pound mega bat. As the Bananas have to scatter, he sends that loopy liner straight towards the dugout. Malachi Mitchell pinch running for Jackson, takes off for second. This one looped towards center and catching it going back is Cespedes for out number three, but that is the best barrel we have seen from Ziggy with the big bat.
And that's what you're going to get when you're swinging a piece of lumber that large. You saw the FerryHawks who were starting to cheat in almost like it was ball four sprint defense, but Alex Ziegler just missed getting a little more mustard on that ball to get it over the head of the center fielder.
The Hokas giveaway is over as you look at the New York Harbor. We will zoom back in to SIUH Community Park because it is time for a blindfolded pillow fight. Nanners lead 2-1 with two innings left on the docket.
In 3-2-1 spin, here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, fight, here we go, starts. But here we go. It's Giovanni and Mike going head to head, swinging hard. They hear the sound. They are fast and furious. The blows are coming fast and hard. We've got 5 more seconds here in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, stop the fight, stop the fight. Man, guys, we gotta vote. We gotta decide who was the best pillow fighter out here. How did we feel about our first Mike? How did we feel? How did we feel about Mike number two? How'd we feel about Giovanni? And how'd we feel about Mike? Here's your winner, ladies and gentlemen, Giovanni!
On the mound for your Savannah Bananas, Zach Phillips. And now batting, number 14, Mikey Edelman.
We look down once again at Staten Island University Hospital Community Park as we get a very brief look at the numbers on the tour so far for Zach Phillips, 27th round draft pick back in 2019 by the Kansas City Royals, who already has an out. Noah Bridges had to wait, I think, longer than I've ever seen in my life for that fly ball off the bat of Mikey Edelman to come down, a guy who homered in his first trip to the pitch on Kyle Lewig's 120-foot pitch and struck out last time on the ball that was on fire.
And that was a ball hit so high in the air, you thought Noah Bridges was gonna try and pop it up to Danny Hosley. And how about this? Only the third pitch of the inning and Noah immediately back out to work with a beautiful lunging catch and right.
It takes care of Luis Castro, leadoff hitter and first baseman, who's now 0 for 4 on the night. And we'll give way to Nick Beardsley, pinch hitting for Ricardo Cespedes, the center fielder. Beardsley steps out of the box. Time was called, so a strike not called on him. Right to Redondo Beach, California, fouls it off out of the ballpark. And has been struck out in an incredibly quick inning from Zach Phillips, who is making a habit of him.
Oh my goodness. This guy pitched a 1 minute and 21 second inning to start the month of August. And here it's Zach Phillips, 5 seconds behind that mark. 1 minute and 26 seconds to go along with a 1 minute and 41 second inning against the Trenton Thunder.
He is on an absolute MPI tear. Phillips has been a menace out of the pen. Guy who came to the Bananas after 4 years in the Royals organization. And kid out of Texarkana, Texas, was built for banana ball. It is still a 2-1 lead for the Nanners as we head to the bottom of the eighth inning and we turn the Big Apple yellow. For 7,000 fans making up 270th straight sold out Bananas game, lighting up the sky with the flashlights on their phones. Here we go. the edge of Staten Island Ferry, the Empire Outlet that you encounter as soon as you get off it if you're coming from Lower Manhattan. Beautiful ballpark built in 2001 for the Staten Island Yankees, Low A affiliate, of course, of the New York Yankees, had to be built at the same time as a park in Brooklyn for the New York Mets, Low A affiliate. Jesse Cole, how cool is it to be here in Staten Island, man?
We love you so much, Banana Nation. Now let's go, Bananas!
Didn't quite answer my question. It was a statement that kind of fit, though. Certainly do love Bananas Nation as you look at a mini version of the Verrazano Bridge. That'll get you from Brooklyn to Staten Island. Zoom out back into SIUH Community Park. Right-handed Ralph still on the bump. And is going to have the bottom of this Bananas lineup here. Dalton Malden trying to feed Eric Jones Jr. and Michael Deeb at the top. And you know, the more we look at right-handed Ralph, the more it looks like extra hitter Mikey Edelman, which is the reason why it makes sense he's not on the roster, was a Staten Island FerryHawk for the vast majority of this season, was recently released, but boy, has made a heck of a statement in his return here against the Bananas.
I mean, you're telling me already a solo home run tonight, and the last inning he pitched for the FerryHawks registered in at 2 minutes and 52 seconds, so not too shabby for Mikey in this Banana Ball debut for him.
Here's the songbird of our generation who stole first base back in the third, came around to score. Chops that one foul, Dalton Malden. In his second world tour, started his Bananas career in the 2021 Breakfast Bowl. Started his collegiate career at the College of Central Florida, 1 year there, another at Bethune-Cookman when he was a teammate of Michael Deebs, who is due up third this inning. And then finished up with 3 years at Trevecca Nazarene University in Nashville, which was a natural new home for a guy who started country, has become a lot more pop, and just gets better and better with age when it comes to his music, as Noah Fisher, the defensive replacement at second, grabs the pop-up. To the top we go, Eric Jones Jr. Pop out, fly out, and strike out tonight. Edelman on the mound, by the way, no stranger to the Atlantic League, was a Long Island Duck last summer, as well as spending some time in the Frontier League as a Quebec Capitale. This one popped off the end of the bat, and EJ 0 for 4 on the night.
And this has been really impressive pitching overall for the Staten Island FerryHawks. Of course, the Bananas only with 2 points in this contest so far. And you just mentioned it, they have held Eric Jones 0 for 4 tonight. This will go down unless we see showdowns or a monster Bananas rally at some point, as Eric Jones, only his second game against a challenger opponent this season where he did not record a base hit.
Michael Deeb is 1 for 3, a single his first time, then a line out and a pop out since. 1-1 count as the Bananas try and figure out the kid out of Long Island University on the Brooklyn campus and Emory University down in Atlanta after that, Mikey Edelman, formerly known as right-handed Ralph. He has shed that moniker though. Now behind Vitamin Deeb, 3 balls and a strike.
And you're still seeing the FerryHawks outfielders playing Michael Deeb very deep but you're starting to see a slight shift in from the center and left fielders, as now this count will run full, deep fouling that one back to the screen.
The former Notre Dame linebacker ready for a payoff pitch with two down here in the bottom of the eighth. And it's going to be fouled out of the ballpark, so he'll get another 3-2 offering from Edelman. After we had three foul balls caught for outs in Trenton, New Jersey, the good folks of New York still looking to snag their first. Deep drives that deep to left field, but able to grab it is Brandon Pugh, and we're heading to the ninth, the young professor.
It is time to cast your gaze upon the scoreboard. Heading into the top of the ninth inning, the score is 2-1 in favor of the Savannah Bananas. But here's the thing about the game of banana ball. In the final inning, every run counts for a point. That means this is the chance for the Staten Island FerryHawks to score some runs and perhaps go past the Bananas. But while they may call Staten Island home, the home team here tonight, the Savannah Bananas, need just three outs to win the whole thing. The stakes are high, so make some noise and welcome to the final inning!
The young professor does not lie, with the Bananas up 2-1. Now every run that is scored counts as a point, which will give the FerryHawks a chance to try and run up the score and claim a victory in this best of one challenger series. Phillips looking for the two out save.
Yeah, and why wouldn't you want to keep Zach Phillips out there on the mound? Again, a 1 minute and 26 second minutes per inning mark in the eighth, and that means you're not throwing a lot of pitches if you're able to do that. Just eight for Zach Phillips, a guy we've seen also get a couple of starts for the Bananas. So no reason not to put him out here for a second inning of work.
Jake Lealios moving it and grooving it like only he can. The starting pitcher for the Bananas, Cowboy Kyle Lewigs, doing the same on top of the Nanners dugout. Phillips throws four-seam, two-seam, and cut fastballs. Works in a curveball and changeup as well. Big part of this FerryHawks lineup. 3, 4, and 5 due to swing it. As we get another mystery man. There is no number 11 on the Staten Island FerryHawks. So Lefty Lou with the 1-1 count on him. I was a betting man. I think this is Daisuke Yoshida, the bench coach of the FerryHawks, which is a gutsy move with the game on the line, but he has worked a full count. And that one just misses the outside corner. Zach Phillips and Bill Leroy cannot believe Vincent Chapman called it ball four, as Yoshida will have first base.
Yeah, and Yoshida actually surprised that Vincent Chapman put up both arms signaling the ball four sprint. He was checking with Chapman before he even started to get down the line. A big part of the reason he was only to get one base on that sprint.
FerryHawks want us to stop play here so that we can have a pinch runner for Yoshida over at first, who represents the potential game-tying run. And it'll be Ryan Mitchelly, members of the FerryHawks pitching staff. I had a Statesville, North Carolina, who will come on in to pinch run. Absolute mayhem here from the FerryHawks in the biggest inning of the night. One, two count on Chris Brito, the third baseman, 2-for-2 with a sprint, and he's able to foul off the backdoor curveball. Heck of a hook there from Phillips. Chop to third, EJ attacks it. Flip to second for one, Malden over to first, not in time. but the Nanners will take the lead runner and the first out here in the ninth as the fans will challenge the play.
And that is an excellent time for the fans to challenge a play. If you're going to use it in the ninth on a possible double play.
Can't take it home with you. Zach Frangelo and Vincent Chapman are ready to rumble down below. Our good folks in the control room, let's take another look. Although, on first look, I agree with Zach that it appeared, Brito, as safe as you could possibly be. Looked safe again there.
Can we slow it down there at the end?
Yeah, either slow it down or get us a new angle. Brito is safe,
he
clearly.
He is safe.
Okay.
Call is confirmed, he's safe.
So the umpires undefeated tonight. This time Randy Voss is vindicated on his original decision. Earlier tonight, it was John Byrne, the third base umpire, who was still correct on his out call at second. Now it'll be Bobby Sparling, the right fielder. One for three on the night, an RBI single that ended up being the inning-winning run back in the third when the FerryHawks beat the Bananas in that inning 3-2. This time he falls victim to the big bender from Zach Phillips and the Staten Island FerryHawks down to their final out.
And that was good banana ball strategy in two different ways. It was Zach Phillips who quick pitched Sparling there, 0-2, missed high with a fastball, and then went to the breaker on 1-2 and was able to get the swing and the miss for the second out.
It's up to Brandon Pugh to keep this game going. That one tapped to Phillips. Sliding, throwing, in time! The Bananas take care of the FerryHawks, 2-1, and have won the Challenger Series against them.
And what an unbelievably athletic play there from Zach Phillips, sliding right in front of him, doing the turn, and Dakota McFadden on the other end, there to secure the out. The Bananas have now won 8 straight against Challengers.
Brings the Nanners to 11-3 against Challenger opponents on the tour, 39-27 overall, as they will turn around and play the Party Animals here in SIUH Community Park tomorrow night. You have to commend the FerryHawks on a heck of a ball game played. It was a barn burner down to the wire, tying run aboard when the Bananas claimed the victory. And we will throw it down to Bill Leroy to celebrate the win for the Savannah Bananas.
Bill Leroy! Up next, we have our wonderful coaches, Coach Adam Virant and Coach Tyler Gillum. And our amazing entertainers, Malachi Flash the Kid Mitchell. Our rodeo clown trick pitcher, Matty Wolf. Our bad trickster, Alex Ziegler. The tallest man in sports, Dakota Stilts Albritton. And last but not least, our first base dancing coach, Maceo. We have our pitchers and reserves, Nolan Daniel, Matt Malatesta, Connor Higgins, Zach Phillips, Jared Donaldson, starting pitcher, Cowboy Kyle Weeks, DJ the Invader, Christian Dearman, and Ryan Kellogg. Holding down the third base position tonight, number 3, Mr. Eric Jones. You know him, you love him. Savannah Bananas, heartthrob, number 9, Noah Bridges. The slugger, wearing number 19 and coming up with the legend, Reginald Horton, Danny Oberst. the YMCA man playing center field tonight, number 18, Danny Hosley. Our trick shortstop, our glove magician, living up to his name tonight, number 6, Ryan Cox. D.R. Meadows has the flu. Coming up next, singing his own song, Miss You, Love You, dropping a song last night, How'd You Keep Her, number 13, Dalton Malden. Check him out on Spotify. The Italian Stallion coming to the mound, number 41, Vinny DeRubius. Number 24, holding down that first base position tonight, Dakota D-Mac McFadden. The barrel man with all the grooves, number 7, Michael Vitamin D. Last but not least, our social media star and our greatest showman, number 8, Jackson Olsen.
To meet you and to thank you guys. We love you, Banana Nation. We'll see you soon.
Well, that was another thrilling challenger game. After a barn burner 4-3 walk-off victory for the Bananas two nights ago in Trenton, New Jersey, the Staten Island FerryHawks put up a heck of a fight, but once again, they cannot survive the Nanners. Alongside Josh Tulevsky, I am Biko Scala. Thank you so much for spending your Big Tiger Friday night with us. That was an absolute doozy, Josh.
I mean, it's always fun to see a pitcher's duel, and overall, it was the Bananas coming away with the win. And how about this? 4 innings of work from the bullpen, no runs allowed, 3 strikeouts. They only allowed 2 base runners. It was phenomenal work yet again from a bullpen that has really helped put the Bananas over 500 against the Party Animals and stay over 500 against the Challengers as well.
Yeah, 3 of those innings thrown by Connor Higgins and Zach Phillips. 1 by Higgins, 2 by Phillips. That is a combined 9 years of minor league baseball experience. And then the other inning handled by Nolan Daniel, who has 4 years of Bananas experience. So they brought out the big guns in the bullpen, and you cannot forget, golly, how about Dakota Stiltz-Albritton coming in and nabbing an out as well as he does now, 25 appearances on the tour without allowing a run to score. It was a thrilling game from start to finish, and after 2 scoreless innings, the FerryHawks, just like the Thunder did 2 nights ago, took the lead tonight. They were up 1-0, but the Bananas were able to storm back and take this thing by a point.
Yeah, and it was just good disciplined batting overall that led to the Bananas win. You saw some sprints and you saw timely hits. And then, of course, the base running. When you're double stealing Bill LaRoy at third base and you get a guy in second base as well, it leads for better scoring opportunities from you and your squad, especially when you're in a tight contest like we saw tonight.
Now, normally right here, I would love to give away the pair of Hokas that were won by somebody tonight. But neither Chad Reese or our queen of Hokas, Mellicent Bean Supreme, have given me that information. So, Tomorrow night on the pregame show starting at 6:30, hopefully we will have a pair of Hokas to give away for you. And as incredible as those FerryHawks were, who now have to turn around and play a day game tomorrow right here in SIUH Community Park, it is so thrilling to see the Party Animals back in action. They got in from their flights a few hours ago. Of course, we had Jake Skull, Reese Hampton, and Dustin Baber on the pregame show tonight, and they are rearing to go. Four games behind the Bananas as we get into this final stretch, and they now have three games against the Nanners here in New York. It'll be tomorrow here in Staten Island, and then at the end of the tour, September 14th in Syracuse and 16th in Cooperstown, the Empire State will be the final state on the docket here on the World Tour to win.
And you can still feel the Party Animals chomping at the bit to get back to 500 and especially over 500 against the Bananas. And really, they won 2 of 3 against the Bananas in Grayson Stadium. Now they just need to be able to control some of the woes they've seen on the road. If they can continue to get good offensive production from Reese Hampton and Jake Skull, who joined us on the broadcast and had incredible series in Grayson a weekend ago, you get the feeling they're going to be in very good shape to possibly win this series up here in the Northeast.
Yeah, and the Party Animals winning 2 out of those 3 games, they take Georgia. So now they add Georgia to Ohio, Texas, and Oklahoma. The Bananas winning Wednesday night have Trenton, but not in the battle against the Party Animals. That gives them, of course, as they won in the capital of New Jersey, that gives them the Garden State, but not in a Bananas versus Party Animals type of way. The Nanners do have 5 states outside of New Jersey, though, as they have won California, North Carolina, Tennessee, Alabama, and Florida. So there are only 6 states left on the docket now, 5 actually, since New Jersey has gone yellow once again with an asterisk on it. And this is going to be a huge first game here in New York tomorrow night between the Nanners and the Party Animals. It's going to be fascinating to see how that one shakes out. Once again, thank you so much to everybody who spent BTV time with us here on Friday night. Big Tiger Friday of all days, and boy, it was an absolute blast. Let's shout out the cast and crew that made it possible. It starts in the control room down in Savannah, Georgia, and it was our director, Keegan Woods, calling all the shots. Griffin Ellis, as per usual, our technical director, executing on said shots, and the brains behind all of the technology that we have ever had in my 4 years here in Banana Land. On the audio, it was KD Duke dominating the ones and the twos. The score bug was handled by Kwanzi, one name, you know him, you love him. On the replay, it was Mr. Jackson Hamilton, couple challenges tonight, knocked him out of the park. Both umpires were vindicated. Congratulations, John Byrne and Mr. Randy Voss. And on the graphics tonight, Julia Massey. On the statistics that you saw on said graphics, Mikey O'Connor, that is a 2-person team. That is absolutely incredible. Here in Staten Island, New York, it was Ben Barks on the first base camera across the diamond from our legend Ben. It was Emerson Elmgren, the Iron Horse of BTV, working approximately her 160th straight game. On the high first camera, it was Henry Campbell, best hair beard combo you'll ever see here in the Empire State. And on the high home camera, it was Clayton Franklin, as good as they come. Dominating the low home, it was Braden Hoskovic. Great to have him on this journey with us. He continues to absolutely kill it. And the wireless cameraman, Mr. Chris Haynes, the official Swiss Army knife of BTV. On the utility and drone, Nick Keldy getting us amazing shots of our ballpark and the New York Harbor right outside it. And our moderators in the YouTube chat, Scott Thompson and Colbite underscore. It was a wild one in the chat tonight. You two are supremely talented and just the best people in the world for the job. On our video legend duo, it is Mr. Chris Saatchi and Zach Bro, our YouTube king, the two best in the biz. And our Zappos / Kate Cup Queen, K-Club Queen, say that 5 times fast, Melly B, Millicent Bean Supreme, Melissa Beal, will have your Zappos winner tomorrow on the pregame show. For Chad Reese, the coordinating producer of BTV, and for Carrie, Emily, Jesse Cole, and Jared Orton, our executive producers, Josh Tulevsky, I almost just blew right by you. You rocked it tonight on the color commentary.
Start spreading the news. The Saugerty Scallywag is back calling games in New York. Fico Scala, great job.
Yeah, it's been a long time since the last one I did here in my home state back in 2017. Thank you to Jake Skull, Reese Hampton, Dustin Baber, and Dan Oberst for joining us in the booth. I am the Saugerty Scallywag himself, Biko Scala, saying so long for now. We will see you tomorrow night. The Bananas take on the Party Animals for round 2 here in Staten Island. Of course, we will see you then, and we will also
see you later!